Good afternoon, everybody. Today, this is post-lunch session. I can understand that a little difficult for everybody. In fact, because the session two was a little delayed, so I understand that some of the people are still in, have been taking their lunch and all. But we can start it because as Madam has some commitments. So just to start the session, we know that bamboo for Northeast is a known material as a raw material also, as a usages wise also, as application. But we have been using it in a very crude manner, despite having 66% almost of the bamboo available in Northeast. So nectar has been happening earlier, North is presently having all the legacy of North, National Mission Bamboo applications, which was earlier under Ministry of Science and Technology, and later merged into Northeast Center for Technology Application and Reach. Though we don't have the kind of pan-India mandate, but Northeast is our domain, and we have been looking in terms of application part majority. Rest of the part, we understand that NMBA do have the complete mandate of raw material till marketing of the product. But for Northeast, we still have the, for Northeast we are, mandate also, as well as schemes also, as well as, experience also in terms of its application part. So this session we thought to bring all the stakeholders of in bamboo sector at one platform, so that we can understand that what are the current challenges in this sector, and what are the possible opportunities in terms of application part also, as well as processing to marketing, everything. So we requested Dr. Alka Bhargav. Dr. Bhargav presently is Principal Chief Conservator of Forest and Head of Forest Force, Assam. She has been Mission Director and Joint Secretary and then Additional Secretary in Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare, and holding the overall charge of National Bamboo Mission also, and having a very big experience in bamboo sector. So she is the chairperson of this session. May I first request her to kindly come on the dais and lead the session.
Okay.
Then you can, absolutely. We have total 8 experts here who will be talking in terms of application and from application to raw material to products and policy. We can request madam to guide us on. The experts are Mr. Sanjeev Karpe, who is the Managing Director, Native Bamboo, Native Contract Bamboo Products Private Limited. He is also having a very large experience, and we have been associating since NMBA, early NMBA days. Then Ms. Sangeeta Vesti, she is Regional Director, South Asia of INBAR. I invite you all. Then Dr. S. Muthukumaranji, he is Dean Research and Consultancy, NIT Trichy. Then Professor Nirmala Chogam, Department of Botany, Punjab University, Chandigarh. Then Mr. Kamish Salem, Executive Director, Southeast Bamboo Foundation. Dr. T.C. Bhuiya, Consultant, Northeast Cane and Bamboo Development Council. Then Mr. Sukanta Samanta, General Manager of AB Composite Private Limited. Mr. Ashish Kumar, Rourav Bharat. Then Dr. Sunita Chetya Talukar from Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India. So may I request Pam to first give her initial remark, and then we may start calling the presentations by the experts.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be very short because I mean we are running out of time, and it would be better to listen to all of you as my fellow panelists. But like Dr. Krishnakumar has already informed that I was kind of led the restructured bamboo mission design and then planning and then implementation. So from those days, I mean, now I mean at the cost of even repetition, now in National Bamboo Mission is looking at the holistic development of the entire bamboo value chain, rather than what it was earlier that NBN used to do the production part and NMDA used to do the post-product and the product development and those things. So now it is end-to-end, and as you all, some of you might be knowing, there are 13 ministries in Government of India who are looking at this. And when we look at the states, then it is either in agriculture or forest or industries. So what I kept telling everyone, that these three departments, regardless of who is anchoring the mission formally, but these three departments are the core for success of this entire endeavor. So if I look at Assam, I mean, we've got a very progressive platform right now, because just about a week back, the cabinet approved the Assam Agroforestry Development Board, which is perhaps the first of its kind in the country. No state has an agroforestry board as such. So we will be trying to bring in all kinds of species, commercially required species into the board, be it bamboo or agar or medicinal herbal plants, and also the tree borne oilseeds is another big sector. So that is a separate thing, but of course when we look at bamboo, it will be one of the very, very core elements of this. So, and also, if you look at the production part, we need a lot of scientific interventions in that also, because we need to improve our productivity. Forest bamboo had very low productivity because obviously it was not getting the kind of inputs, like what we say is cultivated like sugarcane. Give it micro-irrigation, give it fertilizer, give it all those inputs which you would get in a normal agriculture crop, so, and good planting material. So that is where, I mean, if you start the story well, then everything will be fall in place, because the farmers will be happy for the coming 30-40 years if they can get good returns and a ready market. So that is why industry in the middle, and then you work backwards, that what is to be grown where and how and when to be harvested. So that was one issue which we really want more technical assistance. And also is that small farmers, I mean, you don't have that much of big area, so we were doing it through the farmer producer organizations. I remember last, there were about 40 FPOs approved for bamboo and 14 or 15 were for agroforestry. So about 18 are being set up in Assam itself. So, I mean, earlier also, 2 years back, they had used an existing FPO for doing bamboo plantations over, I think it was about 585 hectare or so. So that one, then all the growing, see, paper has gone now. The traditional kind of paper from bamboo. But now you have growing requirements like the 2G ethanol plant coming up in Assam, that has huge requirement of bamboo. So they are into signing agreements with farmers, with FPOs for their supply. Then you have people like, this is one sector which needs to be really promoted, Sanjeev Gathe. And everyone has got that mindset that this is only for small rural housing. But then you look at the amazing structures which are coming up in India itself. You don't have to go to Bali or Indonesia or somewhere else to look at those premium structures. So what we would want is like the rural development, they had the models for the low-cost housing, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, 1.52 lakh houses, and right up to the other end, what Mr. Karpen will be telling us all about. So that is one. Then agarbatti and all those the traditional crafts, we all need infusion of science technology there. Even harvesting is an issue. So surprisingly, Bharat had developed a small contraption which we had showcased to the other states also. So I hope at least some of them have bought those, because when it becomes congested, it's very difficult to harvest bamboo also. So that was a very nice, cool kind of a tool coming from Bharat. It was quite surprising to me also that they are working in this sector also. So that, and then of course we need convergence with other programs. Like for Assam, Narega Panchayati Rural Development is doing huge plantations under the Narega skill, the Assured Employment Guarantee Program. Then Spurti, DC Handicraft, Industries has their own programs, and of course externally aided projects. So that entire gamut of things can be used for this, all to say that tell the farmers to grow exactly what the industry wants, so that there is no glut in prices, or they look for markets after it has attained maturity. So that is where the thing is. And Assam and entire Northeast, we've got a whole fraternity of beautiful artists, traditional craftsmen, but their skills need to be upscaled for contemporary market, because what they're producing right now is a very localized kind of market. So things like what you just seen, those faucets and all the bathroom contraptions and all, those are very nice, very trendy. Come, bring in National Institute of Design for all those little tweaking in the designs and all, so that it falls in place for contemporary people. They will want to buy it. So the last mile, upscaling, branding, finishing and packaging. Make a story out of it. That is how we can sell the hunar, you call it, for of the traditional craftsmen. So I'll close with this. Let's scale our people. Abhinav is here. His institute and any BCBC doing wonderful work in skilling. So that is where we should peg our things on. Catch hold of the unemployed youth, skill them, give this a list to the state bamboo mission so that they can make a cluster for them. They can kind of help them either through the mission, bamboo mission or Spurti or any other way, so that whatever they've learned in BCBI or any BCD or any other NID, any other place, they don't lose it, because we've had thousands of trainings across programs. So if we don't handhold them after that, then they will fall back to what they were doing earlier. So it has to be a kind of a very structured entrepreneur development rather than just simple skill development or training. So I'll stop at that and I look forward to my fellow panelists. We've got a long list, so just request if you can stick to the timeline. Otherwise, probably the organizers will have to serve us dinner also out here. So. Starting with Sanjeevji.
It's actually about 5-10 minutes for each presentation. So let's take a look.
Thank you very much, Dr. Amaloji, and thank you, Arunel Judge, for giving me this opportunity. I'm here to tell you our story, how we started using bamboo as a premium construction raw material in India. So in 2004, we have set up an NGO called CONVAC, Open Bamboo and Cane Development Center, with the technical support from LBAR. And the first thing what we did is we said that we are going to use bamboo as a premium construction raw material, mainstream construction raw material, and we have selected a species. Three species we have selected. The first one is Dendrobamus toxi, another one is Tulda, and third one is Balfour. So second and third one are the species from northeast region. So this is a Dendrobamus toxi species which is from Kopan area. This is your Tulda and this is your Balfour. And then we said that we need to use a treatment for increasing durability of bamboo. And this is the treatment method invented by FRI Derrida's in 1954. It's a pressure treatment method invented by our scientists in India. And this is the structure they have built in 1956 with that treated bamboo, which is intact till date. Not even a single bamboo started decay, even a 1% decay. So we have our own technology, time tested, where if you treat bamboo with this pressure treatment plant, then its durability will be more than 100 years. So we set up a treatment plant with the help of NMPA and we started doing a treatment of bamboo. Then we trained our artisan to make bamboo straight. So by editing you can make bamboo straight. This is a very very traditional method, nothing new in this. Only thing what we did is we trained our people to do this with a more perfection. Putting more efforts to make as straight as a pipe. And with the same method, we could able to bend bamboo without creating any burn mark on the skin of the bamboo. Because you are heating bamboo, it is going to create burn mark. But we have trained our people, no burn mark, absolutely uniform. It will look like any other metal pipe bed. And then converted bamboo into commodity. So treated, graded bamboo available any shape, any size you tell us, we will able to supply you. Even a one piece, one running feet of a bamboo, somebody comes to me and tell me that give me 1 feet of a bamboo of a so-and-so dial, with so and so, I could able to do it. So this is the facility we have created, and using this facility we started with the very simple landscape structures with bamboo, trained our artisans using your artisans from Northeast to train our people, and then we took this forward and tried to create a structure which is acceptable to the tourism industry. So these are the cottage, all the images I am showing you are the pictures of a structure built by us at a different location for different type of clients. And then we decided that we will prefabricate bamboo construction component, just like what you see in the metal construction component. So we started doing that, and after doing that prefabrication, because the code was not available and testing facility was not available, so we said we will test it in our facility. And we started doing this testing, which is perfectly technically sound method of testing. Okay, this is tested under the supervision of qualified structural engineer trained in Colombia. So we could able to do that, and then we started prefabricating components like this, which is then packed and sent to site through a bigger trailer. And then we started using these components on site like this, which is a prefabrication on site. So we did this structure, which is 10,800 square feet of a structure for one builder in Hyderabad. It's a clubhouse for a very high-end villa project. It's 64 feet of a span. Complete skeleton is done in bamboo. No hidden metal element used in this. And this gives us confidence that yes, bamboo can be used as a mainstream construction material. And you can see the actual design of this. And if you want to really see how we have done it, this type of a structural component first produced, and then we could able to assemble it on site like this. So this is the way how bamboo is used in many countries, in Colombia, in Ecuador, in China, in Vietnam. So we could able to do this structure. Then we said that okay, now we have completed this. We need to take it ahead. So we thought that now we should able to do pre-engineered pre-fabricated structure. Even the hole need not to be drilled on site. Everything will happen in the factory. We have done this for a Raja Rajeshwari Temple Trust. This is a banquet of 500 people sitting capacity. We did it at Pulkoti in Karnataka. This is how we did prefabrication of component in factory. And then this is the actual construction on site. So you will see that not even a single hole drilled on site. This is perfectly just like any other pre-engineered building erected on site. And this 6,800 square feet of a structure, skeleton is erected in only 9 days on site with this accuracy and uniformity. So this gives us confidence that yes, now we can do bigger structure in our country. And government of Maharashtra gave us that opportunity. This is the Forest Department Research Institute, 1 lakh square feet of construction done in bamboo by us. So government gave this opportunity, government of Maharashtra, and we could able to build this. Right from roofing to flooring, everything is bamboo here. And we have used 3 different species, different type of joinery methodologies, and could able to satisfy government, PWD, norms, IS code, and we could able to complete it. After that, the major question is about the price. Now everybody needs to know that whether this is really competitive or not. So we got the chance to compete globally. Water of Austria is a very high-end brand of Hilton Hotels. We participated into global tender. This was the resort to be done in Maldives, and they want their bamboo complete restaurant in bamboo. We could able to beat even a Chinese player in that competition. We got that job and we did this work. And this is a very, very high-end resort where the charges for a room night is ranging from 5,000 rupees to 5 lakh rupees to 10 lakh rupees per room night. But we could able to do it, and I am happy that Indian technology, Indian manpower, is globally competitive. We can go abroad, pay their duty, pay transportation, can still be competitive. And this gives us confidence that yes, we can do it. We got 8 jobs in last 2.5 years in Maldives. This is one more restaurant which we did in Maldives. And this is to confirm and tell all of you that we are globally competitive, our bamboo, our people, and our technology is sufficient enough to compete anybody anywhere in the world. So let's do it together, let's do it methodically. Bamboo is definitely core mainstreamer, but we need to also think that this is one more option. Bamboo is a very, very premium one. Thank you.
Respected ma'am, Dr. Radhika Bhargavji, it's always a pleasure to cross paths with like people like her, actually so passionate about this bamboo sector and all, and co-panelist here. So probably I would say that here all these people who are sitting in this hall, they know more about bamboo than me. More about bamboo and also like Ingvar than me, because I'm a bit new. And as Mr. Kapil was telling that the inception of Convec and a few other initiatives, how those could come up with the technical support from Ingvar. I have joined this organization 6 months ago and as a regional director, and basically our regional office is here in Delhi, in India, and we are looking after all the south, the southern part of Asia, and apart from that, few more countries we are looking after on the southeast part. Okay, now time is really best, so I'll just quickly run through a few important things. Particularly, ma'am has already said the tone that what is the importance of having a enabled kind of ecosystem to foster more entrepreneurship opportunities and all. If we look at the ecosystem, we have many elements in the country. Like we have many ministries, we have many technical institutions, we have universities, we have many entrepreneurs who have proven solutions. Now the thing is that despite having all these kind of things, what are the things that we need to do now at this moment to create an enabling environment or ecosystem in the country to foster more and more innovative solutions, entrepreneurship solutions, and diffuse that, meaning helping the people to adopt or adapt those kind of practices. So unless we create a kind of a diffusion base, like those kind of innovative solutions would not be called as like innovative solutions unless it is adopted or adapted by the coming to the Ingvar, the organization and the kind of work that we are doing. So we were established in 1997. It's a multilateral intergovernmental kind of organization. We have a base of about 48 member countries. So our primary mandate and the work that we do is basically to promote environmentally sustainable development by using bamboo and rattan resources, cane resources basically. And we provide different type of solutions, particularly in the area of industrial applications, like how to use bamboo in housing construction area, in lifestyle segment, in energy segment, and also we propagate different solutions to protect and restore the terrestrial ecosystem, like wasteland management and all those kind of things by using bamboo and other waste resources. So our headquarters is in China, and we have 5 regional offices. So Ingvar actually, it works like a knowledge think tank basically in this area. So it propagates different type of industrial solutions, enterprise development solutions, but at the same time it also creates lot of research materials, lot of scientific documents, lot of information inventories are also maintained by us, so that people can get the right kind of technical and also the non-technical like managerial inputs to set up their enterprise or to upgrade their enterprise development work. So we have different task force, like for example to promote bamboo as a green resource which can substitute many less sustainable or unsustainable resources. We have to work on both the sides, meaning sustainable production side, like how bamboo and rattan based resource based applications can be sustainably managed, sustainably produced. This is one aspect. And also, most important part is basically the sustainable consumption part, meaning how the buyers will actually take a well-informed decision to go about a product, given its sustainability aspects, given its environmental sustainability, the economic and also the social sustainability aspects. So we have different task force which actually we are creating this kind of sustainability standards, both from the production side and also the marketing or the consumption side. And we are supporting like the global sustainability standard organizations like ISO. Recently we came up with this sustainability standard of using like bamboo in housing and construction area. So we're working constantly in that area basically to promote this kind of a material in the market and in the sustainability domain. So we promote adaptive research and innovative and you know, different type of R&D activities we do, primarily in collaboration with the technical institutions. And there is also like you can go to our website, which is inva.int. So there is this knowledge bank wherein like one can find all the trade related data, like how much country wise like the import and export of bamboo products and all. So that database is there. And apart from that, there is a section called knowledge bank wherein all the scientific research material. Every year we are coming up with all this kind of scientific research material, primarily to guide the entrepreneurs, the practitioners, the policy makers to take a well-informed decision. So, for example, in 2021, we came up with around 51 very scientific and well-researched materials which are available on our website. These are our member countries. This is our website, and you will go. You will see all this kind of trade-related data, and there are a lot of scientific data which are already available. Nowadays, I mean, like even it, for the policy maker or for the entrepreneurs or everybody, data speaks louder than anything else. Meaning, for any kind of decision to understand its economic viability and also the environmental and social, you know, impact, we need to depend a lot on the trade and also the economic data, basically. To take well-informed decisions. So if you look at all our research reports and all, you will find all these kind of like scientifically proven data which can tell that why we call bamboo as a green material, why we call it as a highly renewable material. I'm not going into the details, but these are scientifically proven, and we have these kind of things which can support our argument that why we talk, why we promote bamboo as a sustainable solution for in many sectors. Just to highlight a bit about like where we are positioned, particularly like we, if you look at a sector within the country like India, we have many sectors. Like in industrial sector, we have, if you take it the 9-digit classification of NIC, there are almost like 99 sectors, and bamboo is like there are many components which are like relevant for multiple sectors. And so to understand where we stand in terms of the global scenario and the national scenario, there are two ways actually. Number one, we can compare ourselves with benchmark like countries like China or Vietnam, many other countries who are like doing quite well in the international. Scenario. And secondly, by comparing ourselves with the other similar kind of sectors. So if you look at like our position in global market, we can see India, it's 2% in the global trade market. This is the latest figure, 2019 figure. Whereas in terms of resource base, all of us, we know that it's almost around 40%, but in terms of value, it is only 2%. So this is one way of looking at like where we stand. Second is within the country, if you look at like there are many industrial sectors. Like for example, out of these 99 sectors, there are about 50 manufacturing sectors. And within those manufacturing sector, if you look at the total number of enterprises, 64 lakh of enterprises generating almost like 111 crores of employment, which means roughly one enterprise employs like two people basically, and largely the family or own account enterprises. Now, in the industrial sector, time, though 99% of the units are like the micro units, but if we compare those sectors with bamboo sector, we will understand that here actually there's huge missing middle population, missing middle enterprises basically. Like for example, 99.9% probably you will find only the micro or household units basically, and you will not see any SME kind of. There is only one probably in the country which is like a small unit, but largely the household unit. So there is a huge missing middle. And when we talk about sustainability, scale, economic values, social implications, environmental implications, unless we have that SME base or the large enterprise base, we'll not be able to generate that much of employment. So in terms of export and import by countries, like just to highlight like India where it stands, bamboo articles and daily uses, it is actually 56 million USD of export we do, whereas import for bamboo raw material, that constitutes the highest. Other components are very less actually here. Possibilities, all of us, we know about the bamboo possibilities. I need not be talking a lot about this thing, but you will see that starting from a very high-end industrial kind of applications like this laptop board, the entire the cover thing, keyboards, accessories, all these kind of things too. The left-hand corner one is actually a woven mat-based furniture or storage space basically. So we already have a lot of good skills and we can use that and make this kind of industrial products in the country. Here also this table you will see here nice accessories are installed there, the quills, and this is a woven kind of like, so matching with like the traditional skills which are already available like in places in Assam and all these kind of things. Little bit of like tweaking in terms of having the right kind of engineering, a lot of good products can come up. Basic utility items, all based on the traditional skills. These are kind of little fast moving kind of cutlery items and other lifestyle products. Fabric we'll know. I'm not advocating anything here in this forum because we need to understand, like many people out of like excitement we tell that a toothpick or something manufactured in India going to suppose our European market is can be considered as green, but we do not sometimes understand or evaluate or value those other elements which are actually going into that, like the transportation, we burn a lot of fuel and so many things. And that is why precisely we are focusing a lot on creating those kind of, you know, scientific inventories and the data basically to understand whether the product after life cycle, what is the value within the process, what is the energy and the other input cost going into that, and what is the total environmental implication along with the economic and social implication by products and products. Now the topic, the entire this forum is actually focusing a lot on this science and technology related innovation. I just wanted to touch upon this aspect of that. Like when we look at like starting from a very product ideation level, when something comes to our mind, like the accessories that you are actually showing here. So something which is coming to our mind, it is just an ideation level. But we call an innovation a successful innovation where it travels from the ideational level to the sustainability or the commercialized level basically. So once we have the idea, then we do the R&D. Maybe in-house, if we have the capacity, we do the R&D. Or we collaborate with institutions and do the R&D. Then we demonstrate that in terms of like whether it will have any kind of economic value, environmental value or not, we demonstrate that. Then once that demonstration is there and we are convinced that this is a proven solution, meaning it has the impact, then we diffuse that. Within our unit, we diffuse that, and then in collaboration with others, we diffuse in the ecosystem. And the last is the sustainability or the commercialization. So unless an idea is fully commercialized, we see a scale there, we'll not be able to call an innovation as a sustainable innovation. Now looking at our experience, you will see that in each of these nodes, there are a lot of inputs which will go into that. Sometimes people, they have the ability to ideate, but many people they do not have, particularly the household units and all. they need a technical guidance or actually support to ideate something, create a solution. From the ideation level to R&D, we need finance. Many people, they have their in-house capacity, but largely people do not have the capacity to invest. We need the infrastructure, and that's why there are technical institutions and many people who can collaborate with and given the technical solution to do the R&D. So here, in each of these nodes, we'll find that lot of inputs are required. I'll just take a couple of minutes. So all these kind of inputs are required. Now, let us look at the bamboo sector in the country and how actually we can create a good base of diffused solution, because that is something which is completely missing in the sector. We have proven solutions somewhere in the laboratory, somewhere in the with the entrepreneurs also, but we do not see a diffused base. Now, like in any sector, whether it's bamboo or textile or leather or any sector, you will not see many innovators. The innovator population, this is scientifically proven also based on our research, the innovators population is a very small segment, 2.5%. So we have to see that what kind of incentives or what kind of mechanism would be required to take those 2.5% to 100% actually to create a good base of people here. Now let's come to the bamboo sector in the country, and ma'am was already highlighting like how many ministries, how many people we have. 15 ministries she told that they are directly having some kind of schemes or some kind of support for the bamboo. So these are the three important pillars of the economy with respect to bamboo, I'm saying, which are there. But what is missing is the collaboration between these, active collaboration between these three important pillars. Now, if you look globally, if you see whether it's a Sinus Valley or Silicon Valley, or for that matter, any kind of benchmark cluster, even in bamboo, suppose Anji cluster of China, that is considered as a benchmark cluster, we will see that the policy, the enterprise pillar, and the academia, these are the three important pillars who are quite strongly collaborating with each other, and then they are actually being able to support that kind of an innovation ecosystem in the country to diffuse the ideas. So this is the overall situation. We did a bit of mapping actually, that how many people are there. Now we at Inbark, our primary role is basically, and this is something which we are actually giving ourselves different targets at this moment, is that how to bring all these three important pillars together to create that kind of an enabling ecosystem which can actually support this kind of innovation and also the diffusion part of innovation, which will have the economic, environment, and the social implication in the country. So how to create the dots so that the ecosystem is well connected, there is inter and intra connection between the stakeholders, and opportunities are created. So this is the entire chain. All of us, we know we have primary processing units. We have schemes for creating secondary processing units and common facility, then we have markets and all. These kind of enablers are already there in the ecosystem. What we need to create is basically the dot. So gone are the days when like everything was always like government driven, meaning there were incentives, there were subsidies, there were somebody else was taking decision for the industry. But now, even in our like kind of multilateral organization, or even the ministries or the policy stakeholders, everybody is focusing on the private sector driven initiatives basically. So the enterprise are at the core, and they have to be enabled to then drive the entire industrial revolution, then only these things are possible. Just giving a small kind of example, just last slide only. This is an exercise we did in another sector. I'm just giving this example because like there are already a lot of opportunities which are locally available. Meaning, not only in manufacturing, taking bamboo as a traditional kind of a skill-based sector or something, lot of these kind of items can be, service enterprises can also be promoted. Like that was a very old kind of haveli in Gujarat. We converted that into this beautiful bread and breakfast kind of industry by doing little bit of like, the refinements and restoration of the building and all. So similarly, Assam is well quite rich in the traditional bamboo houses and so many things which can be actually converted into this kind of like tourist attractions. People can come, stay, and feel those kind of things, and it can create a lot of opportunities. So this is how collectively we created opportunities in Gujarat. So the idea was to highlight like opportunities are there at each and every nodes of the value chain, whether it's a manufacturing value chain or in a service value chain. Basically, we need to understand like how those opportunities or the ideas can be converted to a business solution. And therein, like Inbar, I mean, it wishes to collaborate with all the stakeholders in the Northeast region and also across the country to create this kind of an enabling environment. Thank you.
Composite Paragon of this composite, biodegradable, and again, nano fiber, so that if this type of, if this is successful, we can use midway in construction. We cannot completely eliminate steel, but we can slowly, we can increase the utility of bamboo. That's my interest. So, polymer matrix will be and we are doing a lot of testing, strength and peel test. So many tests we can do. And now I started small work in this area.
So, model also I got successfully. So, this can be used in construction. So, and my expertise in welding, and I developed one new process by that we can build different grades of materials. And here, now recently I started this to join bamboo with metals. Because this process, even Germany, they started using my process what I invented in Germany, not only manufacturing. Now, my intention is to join bamboo with metal. Some technique, some coating, something. Just I started working. So if this is developed, then this also enhances the application of bamboo in construction industry. Because 7075 aluminum alloy is a very good material, very good strength, lot of advantages. Because it is non-weldable, it's considered non-weldable grade, its application is limited. We cannot, without joining, we cannot make component. So it is classified as non-weldable grade. So bamboo also, if at all we are able to do some joining, if you are able to join, if you are able to make this type of product, our application will improve. So we can replace steel to some extent at least.
So that's what I want to say.
And then second part of my presentation is another 5 minutes, madam. Just a flood rescue device. This already model also I've got, I can show you. So lot of flood related problems already we are aware. This road and even Chennai also we are getting lot of flood nowadays. So this is the pattern I file in flood rescue device. This can be used as a furniture. In case of flood, it can be rotated 180 degree and used for rescue. So this is my invention. I file pattern. I made a product also. So this can be given to flood risk areas, houses in flood risk areas, NGO or government or startup, whatever it may be. So that at least valuable lives can be saved. Because after 2015, there was a major flood in Chennai that triggered me to think something should be done to the people to at least to save the kids, the aged people. Because we can run, but how will they run? So it's really a challenge. So this triggered me and I felt this pattern. I constantly made the product and tested it's functioning well. Just I want to share with you. So this is my Hanley method, and this is a product which is fabricated by polymer matrix composite, and it can be used as a furniture in the houses, and I used to play chess with my daughter, and this is we tested in our swimming pool. Just I'll play this video. Just I'll skip something so that it is a little video. And it's so small. So supporting it seems. Okay. It's not supporting. It's not supporting. Okay, no problem. I have photographs. It is converted to a rescue device. Yeah. And I brought a professional person and to test whether this is really working. Because this was achieved after 10 failures. I should tell here. After 10 failures, yeah, this is functioning well. So because steel, I use steel, now I've just started working using bamboo for this. That also I'll show you. And a professional person said this is more stable. So I'm happy that this is a good product and this will be useful to the people, those who are in the flood risk area. See, ordinary time they can use as a furniture and in case of flood they can use for rescue. Yeah, I do not know rowing, so at least person can push me. Yeah, so you know.
But how did you manage to balance it? Because furniture needs a flat surface and a boat needs a rounded surface.
That's what the design. That's what the invention. And it's very stable and there is no problem at all. We tested it extensively. But because after long
more iteration we achieved, this was achieved.
You're taking your children there, means you're totally sure.
I share the video clip, and I immediately contacted Nectar because this zone is the most dangerous areas are there. So, Professor Sharma said this is a product we need, and definitely I support you in research.
So, life-saving thing.
Even 10 people can say nothing will happen because very stable design. And this is what I want to share. I brought the model because that I cannot bring a huge thing. Very difficult. It is so I brought a model with bamboo. Now I am working in making this with bamboo and polymer what I have developed. So this is exclusively developed for this purpose. So this is also now I am also planning to work in bamboo fiber for making this polymer. But I need support from different stakeholders, and particularly Nectar can support me, and we can do some more work in this area so that we can see visible product. So not only this can be used in garden. Suppose if that coating, that polymer is applied, it will can have application in roof garden, because life will be good and there won't be water leakage.
Water leakage.
Yeah. So the roof gardening. This I can show you at the end of the presentation. I can show this model I brought. The model I brought. And this is what my kind of shape. Now we are doing in the fire retardant polymers and automated flood rescue device. So it can go there and they can bring people some more research. We are doing in our institute. And these are the things, other bamboo application, construction industry, disinfection devices. These are some of the more research what we are focusing. Thank you for giving this opportunity, because this, as Madam said rightly, we can link people, because some idea is there, somewhere some people are in need, and NGO is ready to help, and the government is ready to fund. It is really a good platform to share the idea and link people. And thank you, Madam. Thank you for this.
Professor Nirmala Chauka, bamboo shoot and processing are very, very important for
us. Because a lot of ideas should not go waste, ultimately. You can save some data, right?
Yes, sir.
Focus more is on the food and
and we can take medicine also. Food and medicine is a very important part, which very we are not much aware of. And cosmetics also is one thing, bridges are coming up. So food, medicine is one of the things which globally it has come up, but in India it still needs to pick up. And I would say that in India, bamboo as a food and medicine is the most neglected part. We will come to later, and I will press a little on why processing is so much important so that this sector can be a commercially successful in India. So shoots are gaining importance as a health food worldwide. Countries like Europe, South America, which was a non-bamboo shoot eating country, they have started exporting, they have started consuming. Plantations are done in 100 hectares. So this is the importance, but in India, not especially, we are maybe so much used that this is a natural resource that we see, we don't look upon it as a health food, and there are reasons for that. But bamboo shoots are used in five-star hotels, in specialty restaurants, and they come at a high price. Whereas our villagers who sell on the food parts, they really don't get the money, but we are importing. That's an irony. We have the largest acreage. We have so many species of edible, which produce edible shoots, but we are not using it. Only in the northeastern states, it is a traditional cuisine. So there is need for modernization, in order that the younger generation, they are still not aware of this. So now it is a superfood, and this is not only just folktales. Now it has been scientifically proved. What is a superfood? A superfood is one which is loaded with nutrients. Bamboo shoots is high in nutrients, vitamin, minerals, fiber, and antioxidants. And now it is scientifically proved in other countries, and also from based on our experiments, we have come to know that it can be a prevention for cardiovascular diseases, lowering the cholesterol level, and also antibiotics. So we are doing research with my system so that it can be applicable for later pharmaceuticals. So traditional knowledge, we have a lot of traditional knowledge, and now it is validated by scientific interventions. Now there is one step forward which has to be taken up, and so it can be used as a vegetable, as a food additive, and ingredient for pharmaceuticals. Now in the nutraceuticals, and now these people are so much aware of health, and so this can be a very good ingredient for functional foods also. So just a quick run through: rich in proteins, carbohydrates, high content of minerals. Potassium is very good for the heart. Calcium is good. It has the highest content of silicon. And fibers also, and then low in fat and sugar. So let's see the global perspective. China, as we know, it is so much far ahead of us in bamboo, and it exports 87% of the entire export market. And just look at this. The data, the trade flow. Countries like Mexico, they are exporting shoes. I remember that 2012 during my lecture in Belgium, and 2015 in Korea, a group of Mexicans, they came up, they asked about me about the bamboo shoots and how it is grown, and now they are exporting to the United States and Italy. Europe is not a naturally bamboo growing country, but Italy is exporting to Germany, Netherlands. So many things, so many countries have picked up, but India is still at the lowest end, 20.84 million, and to UK. So comparing the amount of bamboo which is in India, this is a very dismal performance, because we are not looking it in that way. We are. I'm not saying it is not good, but I think this is an area which has a lot of opportunity for India, especially for the Northeast. So then why? Why is bamboo shoot neglected food item? Because there is lack of awareness. I'm from Chandigarh, from Punjab. Nobody knows that bamboo is edible. They don't know their non-availability. Sometimes after they read, because we are now, there are so many different cuisines coming up, if they want to take bamboo shoots, it is non-available. And then lack of processing. Processing is one thing which is very important, especially with bamboo shoots. If you do not take the appropriate species, if you do not
use the proper processing method, it is not going to work. Because the food products like pickled bamboo pickles which are sold, it has a fermented smell which is not palatable to all. So that is because it is not properly processed. So then lack of proper packaging, we are just selling it on the roadside. So now it needs to be, these are the imported foods which are available in India. Imagine coming from a small country like Bhutan or Australia or Indonesia, it is sold at 245 grams, 170, 150. So there is no domestic market. We are still not at that position where we can even supply to our domestic market. So the challenges, there are a lot of challenges, and we are still importing from Thailand, Bhutan, where in Chandigarh, even in Shillong, their Pinewood Hotel, I went there and they said that they use the shoes coming from Bhutan. And that was in June. That means they don't use the fresh shoes even. So look at the cost. The fresh shoes cost 30 to 60. This is upon our survey. And 30 to 60 kg, but it is selling at 150 to 170 or 300 to 340. So look at, we are losing such an opportunity. And Northeast India has a golden opportunity to enter the international market, because now it is considered as a superfood throughout the globe, and people are going for this, because now everybody, especially because of the pandemic also, now everybody wants to consume health food. So the edible shoots, I have not come across any bamboo shoots, any bamboo species which said this is not edible. It can be very bitter, but only the processing is proper. Every shoot is edible. So in China they have another Philostrichus, in Philippines, Thailand they have different edible species. I can show ours. This is from our studies, Northeast India. It's full of edible bamboos. Central India, East India, Southern India, they have their own. We have a lot of bamboos which can be taken forward for as food. And these are some of the major edible. Latiflorus is one which has big shoots. Then we have gigantius also, which has big shoots. They can be used for commercial purposes. And they vary in shape, size, weight, and diameter. And also the nutrient content is different. But we have selected at least five, which can be, because we have also to see the yield. If the yield is good, then the farmer is going to earn more. So this is our survey. Fresh shoots, as I told you, from 30 to 60 rupees, that is the cost in one for 1 kg. And fermented shoots are much more, they are costly, because of course it takes maybe 3 to 1 year for fermenting. Because the more the time, the longer the time, the more tastier it is thought to be. So what are the challenges for commercialization? Selection of the appropriate species. This, and we need uniform plantation. For example, in Northeast, we are all depending upon natural resources. The tribals go, they cut all any bamboo species and they mix it. But if you go for processing, there will be difference in the crunchiness, in the flavor, in the color. So if you go to the export market, even the domestic, if you open a can after maybe 3 months, the shoots will be variable, which will not be liked by the consumers. So also we need to develop appropriate processing and packaging techniques, and we need plantation so that we can have, like Thailand, they grow hectares of Physocycis yamensis, Philostrichus pubescens. So we need a uniform plantation to have proper raw material, and the shoot reacts differently. So when you take any bamboo species shoots, it will react differently, and so the shoot will be different in crunchiness, color, and also we have to think about the loss of nutrients and the bioactive compounds, which are the health promoting factors. So they need to be taken into consideration. So you can see the difference. When you boil the shoots, they will be a little bit yellow, then soaked shoots, and then fermented, then we can dry it also. So the crunchiness and the color and the flavor all differs with different processing methods. So now this is how it is sold. Fresh market, processed. So I think there are people in the Northeast who have worked here for 20 to 30 years, but they have never tasted it. because it is not a very good sight to look at. Nobody would like to taste it, picking it from the roads. This is one big factor. When the way it is sold, because so this is, it provides a livelihood, women empowerment, but the way it is brought to the public, that has to be improved so that people are attracted. Because I think the first type of food is attraction, the color, how it is put forward. We need a facelift, either vacuum packed or you can put it in simple water, boil it and you can put it. So this one in boiled water, you can keep it in the fridge even for 1 year. We do it. So look at what Mexico has come up. They use Bambusa Lumia and Ohemia and also Esper. So this is how, this is the packing. It is so attractive. I think anybody who is not a bamboo eater would surely like to try. So Brazil, Colombia, they are non-bamboo fruit eating countries, but now they are exporting and they are also domestic market, which is available. Ecuador, Costa Rica, these are where I also went for the to Costa Rica, and so these are provided by my friends who have started their own business. So they grow bamboo in hectares. I remember a friend, 50 hectares is growing bamboo. So the market levels will be different. In the northeast, it can be fresh and fermented shoots. For other regions of India, it can be canned or vacuum packed, and dried canned or fermented for functional food and nutraceuticals. This is a very upcoming field, and for exports, it can be vacuum packed or canned. So there has to be a different level, market levels, according to the needs of the people and the country. Then you can go for bamboo shoot fortified products. There are ice cream, there are cookies. There so many different products can be made from shoots. Then noodles. These are some of the products which we made, and also the scientifically we have all the data for its nutrition and shelf life. So to start a bamboo shoot industry, anybody, we cannot depend on natural resources, because shoots are available for 4 to 5 months. We need proper storage conditions, and also we have to pack it very well. And also when we start a bamboo shoot industry, the non-edible gum sheets, which we normally discard, it can be used for extracting bioactive compounds for pharmaceutical, because it has a lot of phytosterols, it has a lot of phenols, which are antioxidants, and decorative items. In Colombia, they make beautiful decorative items, and then disposable plates also. Dendrocolumbus zagensis has big gum sheets which can be used. So the way forward, so there is abundance of traditional knowledge, and India has just to harness this potential. And the worldwide medicines, cosmetics, fortified food products and nutraceuticals have become a craze. And so we need appropriate species, identify the species and select the proper processing method, and then adopt packaging methods for international standards. So this would be very good, because the shoots can be supplied in the local, domestic and international market. It will create job opportunities and generation of earnings. And then also it will provide the farmers to diversify into an enterprise that is environmentally friendly, and also it will be profitable. So our projects, we have been able to do this work because we have had projects from Ministry of Food Processing Industries, for university grants from DST, Department of Biotechnology. We are so grateful to them, and we have also been funded by Jet Naked Foundation and the American Food Society. And so this is a short compilation of
thank
what
you. We have done. We are sorry to interrupt you.
Okay.
We've got six more.
Okay. Thank you.
Eminent speakers. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Chair, and my fellow colleagues.
Just a request, can we just restrict to the actual bhote ki baat jo bolte hain?
I will just have a marathon run. Speaking on the value chain of bamboo, I think which is very important. In Northeast, we have seen a lot of bamboo industries coming up, or it has not succeeded. And there are reasons behind that. It's basically because of value chain management. And in fact, I'm happy with the Carpe's international quality of work, where maximum bamboo has been used. But in other sector, so again, we look at SDG goals. So I will not put line by line, I'll just show the slides, but the time is too short. I'll come back to the point. I give it to Mahatma Gandhiji because SDG 1 is in sync with Gandhiji's, the villages would be empowered with bamboo. But you know, you have to see these slides very carefully. What our predecessors said 150 years ago, without bamboos, India will be very, very poor. Again, our President Kalam, what he says about the value chain management in his speech for the 56th Republic Day parade. So Republic Day. So these are a few things which we have to take back. This includes setting up clusters, small irrigation processing units. This is basically the idea. So SDG, where it contributes in bamboo, Bobland Foundation, I will not go into details. And also one of my contributions is to declare bamboo as a non-grass, which both the parliament acknowledges my name. So because of that, I was awarded Green Activist in 2019. So there are low awareness of bamboo, there are need for building awareness. I will not go into details, we all know about it. When we come to the point where the technology will come from, the opportunities, which we all know about bamboo again. So this is distribution, what is bamboo? It's basically grass. We always look at Chinese bamboo and we always say bamboo is all same, it's not same. Because there's imported bamboo and there's monopodial bamboo. We work with imported bamboo, which is very hard, silica content is very high, harvesting is difficult, processing is difficult, we have to take into consideration. We cannot compare with Mozo bamboo and say bamboos are very soft. So these are the bamboo recommended National Bamboo Mission, because these are again very important. So this is very important about bamboo, the grading of bamboo. You see the different types of bamboo, different size of bamboo are available. Then again, this is unmanaged bamboo club we always see, but where else you see a managed camp? This is not in India, this is in Timor Leste. I worked there for some time. Again, here the planting material is very important. This is basically community-based planting material in Nagaland. Selection of good quality material is very important. Again, here, this is a point I want to show you. This is in Taiwan. Tea and bamboo grow side by side. Both are managed as commodity. This needs to be seen. Then again, more of transportation. How bamboo is transported from one place to another. Again, here in the NC Hills, how the bamboos have been drastically cut to take to paper mills. Again, river route is one of the most important. Thousands and thousands of bamboos flow down to Bangladesh from India to fit a paper mill there, the kind of fully paper mill. So this is one of the routes how bamboos are taken across the border. And bamboo, water would have been one of the best route for bamboo. Again here, young, old bamboo, everything is slashed in the NC Hills, in the erstwhile paper mills, HPC, drastic cutting of bamboo. Again, this is the India's largest bamboo market on the Kokrajhar district in Gosaigaon. These bamboos are going to every part of India. You can see the railway station here. This bamboo goes all over the Madhya Pradesh in train loads. So there's a huge, already traditional market exists. But you see bamboo in our culture, you know, agriculture, architecture. We have a culture on bamboo, the fencing, we have the baskets. I'm showing baskets. Why? These are the traditional knowledge of Northeast. Different tribes has its own baskets. You can identify the tribe by seeing the basket itself, the Mizo, the Nimasa. Then, you know, women importance, all is spoken about. This is in Manipur, women making these bamboo baskets, we call it long. Then also commerce in the village heart, we exchange bamboo with other commodity. Then bamboo mat board, these are the challenges. This is again some cottages in Goa. When I came, they asked me, Mr. Salam, these are the cottages which is powdered. What to do? I said, you just burn them. There's no way out. So treatment is one of the main issues. The negative part of bamboo is that the powder. So what do you think this man will ever make a bamboo cottage again? No, never. He's only burned his fingers. So these are the issues of bamboo. The sugar content, the cellulose content is very high. This is why the 2G ethanol plant is coming. These are the things that comes to mind when you look at bamboo. The best furniture, if you see, the mind will come here. Whether, when, how long my bamboo is going to last? How long my furniture is going to last? How long my cottage is going to last? So these are the issues. But again, you have a traditional knowledge. These are the streets of Bihar in Patna, where they are using bamboo. These are all not treated properly, but they have been treated with traditional knowledge. They have been blended with traditional knowledge. So traditional knowledge exists with us. Again, grading and sizing, very important for bamboo. Kartik has shown in his slides. Again, here, every part of bamboo is marked. 100 mm, 50 mm. It's very easy to identify. This is how the bamboo has to be, you know, segregated for bamboo marketing. Again, I show a small value chain mapping in Punjab, where I did some work in Hoshiarpur. But bamboos are selected, we try to map the bamboo, then bamboos are sold in different varieties, different types. This is in Talwara village in Punjab. So bamboos are sold like this, but what we did was that we put our student, one of my students was an intern, then he made these furniture from those bamboos, then it was exhibited in Dubai. So we are trying to make furniture from the bamboo strictest available in Punjab. So again, same in China, every processing is done in the middle level, it's easy to carry. Value chain, supply chain is very important again. Primary processing for agarbatti in Vietnam. These are right in the heart of the jungle, they are cutting bamboo. We cannot imagine in India. So when we say that the Vietnamese price are low because of these factors, again here you see all the pulp is being graded. Every part is segregated right in the, at the source. So one part is going to paper mill, one going to fabric sector, one going to charcoal unit. Then again, what approach we did? Innovative approach, market-driven approach, material-specific approach, sector-specific approach, technique-specific approach. These are the approach we need to take in bamboo. Innovative. With little bamboo, innovation price is very high. Again, market approach. You have bamboo which can be folded because bamboo carries a lot of weight, a lot of size. So these are the folding bamboo which we did in Nagaland. This is special, the Karla Mara bamboo. This is another bamboo split, the round bamboo which got the used to see. This is again the furniture. Sector, furniture is a good market. Bamboo, the toy sector. Technique, from bamboo mix, the conference bags have been made. Again here, with less bamboo like hanger, the price is very high. So little bamboo uses Kerala again and Angamali. From the bamboo made weavers, these are the products can be made. In Tripura, Katlamara, again from round bamboo, this can be made. Barpeta again, here you see the bamboo, the Bijuli bar, again making the bamboo stroke. But here I didn't like was the hygienic condition, which needs to be looked into. Again, we don't know to know the, my key point where I'm coming is the actors in the value chain. So bamboo is a business, money, labor, inputs. These are different types of bamboo available. Traditional, industrial, construction, food, medicine. From slivers, this can be made from strips, from particles, from composites. But again, here you see in the bamboo sector, there are many players. Right from the harvesting from the jungle to the roadside use pulling, the truck driver, the policeman, the forest guard. There's many actors in the bamboo sector. So we need to identify them. Constant in value chain, I'll not read line by line now. Again, just a mapping of value chain. This is very important. From the clump, from the leaves, from the twigs, from the top part, from the lower part, what can be made in bamboo? We have not been doing this. That's why we have more loss. A person is making agarbatti stick. But again, there's loss. Existing value chain, the farmers, the bamboo collectors, artisans, wholesalers, retailer, customer, the raw value chain, again here, these are actors. Again here, this is a very important, which I did a bamboo when he was on paper mill. There are two types of bamboo value chain, one and second. And how many people, bamboo that costs 20 rupees costs around 100 rupees in the market. Who are the people paying in between? This needs to be identified. Again, who makes the maximum profit in the value chain? You see? The cultivator, the collector, local trader, the wholesaler. So these are how the profits are being made in bamboo sector. Bamboo mat cluster in Kerala and Nagaland. This is how, again, a very big industry here. This mat goes all over India. This is in Kanpur in Assam. This is Nagaland Puli district. Again, here they make bamboo mat board and bamboo roofing seed. The bamboo value chain of bamboo soup was described, but the problem here is that this is seasonal. Many people say they want to put a bamboo unit, but in 4 months, what can they do? So bamboo is the issue again, but Nagaland has done a big job in the value chain, like in the bamboo suits, you can see pickles and all they are making. Again, another area where we can interfere is the packaging sector. You see the bamboo, how packaging we use. We can innovate here. I want people to innovate in the packaging sector. This is a big area. You see people are packing oranges. These are, just recently I bought oranges from Arunachal Pradesh. You see the people are packing the dry fish. But here you can see Myanmar and Bangkok and Thailand, they are packing gift. So another issue is the when we start an industry, we don't manage the flow. So it is another area, I have seen a lot of factories in Northeast where they indicate say lack of professionalism, another key issue. They just put the light like this, they don't manage it properly. This is, these are real pictures of some of the, you know, the Spruti and, you know, this the KBIC projects. This is how they're PCMC in the city, some units are still not open also after coming. Another imported resin from China. And in dump in Assam, because those are for softer bamboo. It is not working. Huge investment going west. Again, in Northeast, again, they are good worksmen. Innovations in bamboo. Like the bamboo bottles. In Manipur, they're making the bamboo tiffin. In Tripura also bamboo bottles have come. And the CM has started this also bamboo cookies. Again, innovations have taken place other part of the world. In many places, like you see the airport in Amsterdam, in Madrid. So bicycles, then the Audi, this thing. But again, in bamboo charcoal, let me come. People have put a bamboo charcoal, they failed because they tried to burn the entire bamboo. So it is not possible. See, they're buying only the waste. In the West, this lady, she's exporting bamboo charcoal to this in Thanwa province in Vietnam. She's exporting to Japan this bamboo charcoal. Why bamboo charcoal? I'll not go line by line, but this value chain of bamboo charcoal, harvest, bamboo process, cooling, packaging. This is how the value chain of bamboo, value chain goes. These are the development of bamboo charcoal products. Again, here I'm showing you that how bamboo charcoal is getting is being done and being exported from West. This is in Thailand. They use for body scrubbers. So bamboo waste are being used as bamboo scrubbers for body. Again, from the dust, they make bamboo briquettes. This is also a big challenge because most of the coal mines are being closed down, and Dalmia and many companies have been asked to switch over to green material. So I see the bamboo briquettes as a big future here. So not a particle of bamboo cannot be wasted. So supply chain of bamboo right from the forest, the bamboo producers, you can come there. So this is important of the benchmarking. In India, our wastage is 50 to 70%. Why? Because on one product, you're doing everything. Whereas in China or in Vietnam, the wastage is 5 to 10%. Even 5 to 10% they're utilizing as briquetting. So you talk about ethanol. I was one of the expert for the PricewaterhouseCoopers house who designed the NRL's bioethanol. This is the value chain on bioethanol. How it will bamboo will produce, how will it procurement, how the processing, transportation, ethanol production. Again, this is a model which I want to share with you. This is the best model I have seen in my career of 30 years, like how the bamboo growers, bamboo processors, bamboo finishing is being segregated. This is something we need here. Yeah, I'm just finishing.
Yeah.
So this is something I work. So my craftsmen who are making bamboo toilets, set toilets of the Swachh Bharat, which is very popular in Nagaland. We make toilets in Nagaland. Every house uses bamboo toilets. Even the septic tanks we use bamboo for Swachh Bharat. And these are toilets we make in Arunachal Pradesh. This is in Kaziranga National Park, used in pay toilet. There are some innovations possible. So, like in Ladakh, not as good as Karpe, but we try to do some good work in bamboo. So these are two of the monuments we have done in Guwahati. There's two footbridges that has come up. One very near here, even half a kilometer from Sukhdesho Bridge, which was done by my artisans who are making bamboo toilets. This is the Taj Bhiwanda, where it could have 6 months, we completed 2 months during the COVID, during the lockdown time, so a lot of problems we had. But we did a good job using Malpua bamboo. So this is the work we did in Taj Bhiwanda site, which is one of the landmark of Guwahati city today. So these are some of the work done by my artisans, my workers. This is here in Sukhdesho, just I said you can just walk and see. This is done with Kanekas using from Tripura. So this is then again we started making a bamboo app. This is the app. I think you can download this app. This app is going to be a tool for learning with the people. We will be doing e-learning courses using this app. Then the book was released by Bamboo Chat by Nitin Gadkari in Delhi. So this book is available here also. World Bamboo Day started by me. So this year we did a lot of competitions, and these are some of the prize winning, the photography, the furniture design, product design. So these are bamboo cycles started in Manipur. Thank you so much.
it is a Pullman Swarambu, now it is a Swarambu Digit Quadrant District. So some of the information, there is a disclosure, I will just keep all the slides. You can have a look about the bamboo bearing areas, about the status of mountains, the stock position, then your views. It is everything I will just skip. Then here you can say the for plantation. What is the requirement? Actually, basic requirement for it is the planting material. Because for seed, for other cases, seed is okay, it's fine. If you get the seed, then immediately you can go for seed for cultivation and all. But for getting seed, it is a problem for the bamboos. It takes about 30 years, 40 years, sometimes more than that. So our primitive method is the rhizome plantation. But rhizome plantation, if commercial comes, you cannot use the rhizome for the large scale commercial cultivation. Because we know that only first year and second year bamboo rhizome can give you the new sprouts. So you can't expect that where lots of bamboo rhizome, you can go for plantation. But cypress are limited. Plantation, you can use rhizome, no problem. But what we did, during 2002 to 2003, we did some experiment. We went to cuttings. From the cuttings, how we can get the seedlings. Okay? People say nursery bed, it is very common. I don't like them. About the seed, that is also I described. It is very common. Very easily you can use the seeds for, that is, there is no hi-fi technique. If you get the seed, it is easy. But here only thing is that its diameter is very short. It's generally 3 weeks at time. Generally, it remains viable. Otherwise, it's lose the viability. And if you sow in the seed bed also, it will just germinate at all. So for that purpose, no, it is at the state of zero risk, you can go for that. That seed collection, that is superior material, that lots of things are there. But we are not going to tell about these things. Then picking out, this is a common practice, transportation. Then propagation through cuttings, that is very important. You see, for the propagation through cuttings, there are important three factors. That is season, age to come, and growth regulator. We try different concentration of your growth regulators, IBA, then growing seed, and different type of concentration we try. Then season. Season we try to do different times, no? But this time is the April, May, then March also, it is very good time, March, that means before pre-monsoon, you can start up the work. Then age of account, we try to do the first year, second year, third year, fourth year like this. Series of experiment we did, but what we find is 1.5, 1.5 from the maximum 2 years bamboo, it is good for cum cutting. Then what we applied the hormone, that is we tried with a different hormone, but we tried with the IBA, indole-butyric acid, that is the 200 ppm solution we put. That IBA initially did not dissolve in water, so we did what we did, that is the, we dissolve it in alcohol, that is 20 ml ethyl alcohol, then you mix with the 10 liter of solution. Then we put in the cavity of the internodes 200 ml only. So if it is a thick wall bamboo, where you cannot punch it, then you can just dip it for 24 hours. That way, we are getting good result before planting in the bed. So we are using this bamboo, this is a fungicide, it is a 0.1% solution. Then this way, we are just planting in the slant cut because more area it will cover, because that is the only area where it can absorb the water. So we can put the here position, you can see that you place the cuttings like this, the node should be in the sideway, the hole should be in the top, and slanting cut should be downward so that it can form properly in the soil. So you can see initially what happened, that within say 23-25 days, we have observed that new sprouts will come, but it doesn't mean that it survived. But in second stage, since we are giving the hormone, then new roots develop. Then new roots develop, then new rhizome will come, then we can say that yes, some of your cuttings are success. So for this purpose, at least minimum 4 months time it equal. Here, from the cuttings also, we have tried with the cuttings, different type of cuttings, but here only factor is that where there is very thin. Here you can see the, right now, this is a small branching, but it is a false island. Roots are also there, buds are also there, particularly those bamboos having this type of stout branching, particularly bamboos of Belpua, Dantulus, Sangiltrona, then Dantulus, Aspar, bamboos of bamboos, this type of species, you can try to do this branching. But this here also same factor, that the age factor, that is 1.5 years, 2 years age, the same condition, you can cut and you can place in the polybag or in the directly under your bed. Here you can see the different, how it develops the roots and the new rhizomes, different stages.
Actually, we have another session also in this.
Okay. So, then here you can see the micro-proliferation. That is the process. There's the advantage and disadvantage. Here you can see. Then plantation, for this plantation, we have to go for, depending upon your target, you can go for your large-scale commercial cultivation. Then here I put, there's a 2 to 3 species, because if you do not know the age, or actual age of plant, your planting material, so it may plant after, say, for give flowers after 2 to 3 months, even after 2 years also, then you won't get anything. So if you mix up 2 to 3 species, then if one species is flowers, at least you can get another 2 to 3 species, it will give you the product. So if it is known year, if it is a 0 year, then it's fine. It will go up to say 30 years or 34 years or 30. Even in the tissue culture also, you do not know. Even in the test tube also, it will flop. Because it carries the age of the original mother. Then here is the different concern. These are different commercially important species. I'll just skip all the slides. These are, these are all different species, important species, then in the plantation, then the species, then you provide, this is commercial purpose, that is 5x5, then if it is a very large term of example, like the Dantulus, Jagintia, Dantulus, Lentiflorus, these 40 species, at least you can go for 10x10. In case of peat, it is a 50x50, then it's all cross-cutting, but here the level you follow, that is the down of this plantation. Because its root system, no, if bamboos, the crown, whatever the crown it goes, the root system is a trail like this. If it is crown is less, then the root system is. So that way there is a less competition if you go for the V-shaped plantation. Then in offset plantation, these are suits. I'll go to the management part. The come elongation, you can see that initially what happens mostly in the beginning with the rainy season, it takes for elongation for new sprouts to the full growth, it takes 60 to 120 days. It depends upon species to species. Then in the post monsoon season, what about the new sprouts? It comes and it perishes. We can say it goes up to say 10 feet, then it prints. Then come production, everything it depends upon the soil quality and fertility and all. Okay. Then management purchases, soil reasoning, then your methods, then soil covering pilots, then these are things, then drainage. Then I did some experiment on this, your fertilizer manure. Here I tried with a different concentration. What I find, it is the 400 gram, 200 gram, 80 grams, 10 kg of carbon. Here, the growth, then your internal lung, it is not very prominent, but not significant at all. But number of new sprouts, it goes up to more than 80%. Sometimes it costs 120% also. I tried in 3 locations in Assam. Here, this is the method. Then harvesting, you know, these are the rules and regulations. I'm not going to explain much. That is condition of the forest, that is regions. Then there's how to do work. One experiment I did with the intercropping with the different species. That's because we are giving 5 meter spacing. Okay. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Sorry. My name is Ashish Kumar, as introduced. I am from Gaurav Bharat. I'll give you a different perspective, which I give always. We have launched almost 550 products in this lockdown itself in various categories. And I won't touch any scientific aspect today on the Dhamapur products, because after listening, sir, it was an enlightening session. I won't touch those aspects which has already come. I'll touch the aspect which probably Mr. King Shuk must be facing, or ma'am, you. For your information, I am a bamboo shoot lover. Me, wife and family go to special bamboo shoot dinners and breakfast. What problems are we facing? If I touch bamboo shoot as a byproduct of bamboo wood industry, bamboo industry, food processing has its own challenges, whether it is quality standards, the cultivation, preservation, wastage of the raw material, processing, packaging. Finest of the world today are suffering because of bad marketing, bad packaging, bad presentations, bad positionings, and bad marketing awareness. Today, bamboo wood industry is also facing the same challenge. It is one of the challenge. I am touching only business point of view. I know a lot of bamboo wood timber, bamboo wood plywood, bamboo wood material is available in the market today, but nobody is buying. I am talking about dealer distributor network. Currently, ROI is not available because they cannot sell. Market acceptability is not there. We are in premature stage. There are scientific progresses which are happening, but business point of view, I know he must be relating. Right customer acceptability on the product. Right ROI on the advertisement front.
The awareness part.
Awareness aspect is hugely missing. Bamboo wood pickle. It is very famous in Ayurveda. We are producing many products in Ayurveda and nutritional products, and we use bamboo wood shoot as raw material, but there is the same challenge. We have also worked on bamboo wood charcoal. We are procuring bamboo wood charcoal to use in cosmetics, to skincare industry, to soaps. Same challenges we are facing there. Whole bamboo wood, whole bamboo is getting wasted. There is a need of proper supply chain optimization in the overall processing. We need to think end to end sustainability in terms of environment as well as financial. This is the biggest challenge which I am seeing in bamboo wood industry, be it any sector, fiber, textile, food, food byproducts, timber, furniture. We are working on furniture a lot, but procuring bamboo wood is a challenge. Cultivating bamboo wood is a challenge. If I grow bamboo wood in any part of other sector in India or maybe North region, first I need to wait for 5 years to make that yield come out. So we need to think where whole story is fitting in for SME sector and new startups. The opportunity is with the new startups, new minds which can think out of the box, which can actually take bamboo shoot product to global using internet as a marketing tool with right kind of packaging. So that is the key area which we need to work right now for the bamboo wood industry to survive, because right now whatever we are discussing, it is affecting the large scale industry with the capacity of 5,000 or 500 or 800 crore budget. But rest of the people are looking for immediate returns and profitability in bamboo industry or bamboo industry. I was requesting dealer network and distributor network a lot for last 1 year to pick bamboo wood ply, but nobody is ready to pick. They are clearly saying there is no market readiness right now. So along with the scientific things, we must work on the awareness part of it. If National Bamboo Mission is doing a lot of things in scientific arena, they should work on the marketing front of it. We are startup curator, we are business accelerator, so I talk business. I am waiting for the day when Kinshu should be a buzz in the market. What is the finest quality innovation he has put in the product? And I got to know, ma'am, you today itself. It is the very right product, very right product. You should work on the branding and every part of it. It will be a big change, big thing in the market. Like Meghalaya, you see turmeric is creating a buzz in international market. This bamboo wood shoot will really create buzz, similar buzz. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
May I now request Dr. Smita Chetia Talukdar from PDI Guwahati.
Good evening to one and all in the meeting room today. So being the last presenter, I have the advantage of, my co-speakers speaking about every aspect of bamboo, whether it may be, cultivation, whether it may be innovation, whether it may be startups, everything has been talked about in this forum. So nothing actually has been left for me. But then still, being a person from entrepreneurship, I would like to highlight one thing. Although my co-speakers have been repeatedly saying this, I would also like to highlight the fact that with a productivity, potential of 30 tons in an acre in a year, okay, and the capability to mature in a period of 3 to 4 years. And in fact, if you give a conducive environment, I have even read that, the bamboo grass can grow in feet in a day, right? In foots in a day. So, it is indeed a green goal for us. So I will not speak up much about anything else, but yes, I would speak about some declarations, some announcements by the ministry, by our honorable CM, wherein it has been stated that under the Atmanirbhar Bharat package, it has been announced that around 4,000 crore, credit guarantee trust for micro and small enterprises is there available. And there's a provisioning of rupees 20,000 crore as subordinate debt to provide equity support to distressed MSMEs. So this is the economics which I wanted to give. And not talking much about all these things, I would stress that yes, in the bamboo sector, if we say that what is happening in the rural areas, what are the enterprises which are actually governing this particular sector are the micro enterprises. Correct me if I'm wrong, I'm telling that micro enterprises play a major role in this particular sector. So, as a person from entrepreneurship, from an organization termed as Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, there we believe that entrepreneurs are, not born, they're created. And yes, through our efforts, through our, design efforts, we at EDII have designed programs like awareness, entrepreneurship awareness camps and entrepreneurship awareness programs, and EDB programs, entrepreneurship development programs. My prior speaker stated that awareness is one aspect which needs to be focused on, which needs to be actually, looked upon by every stakeholder in this particular value chain. Yes, that is one, that general awareness is very important. And I would emphasize on awareness in entrepreneurship. People needs to be made aware about entrepreneurship. It is not that, it happens over the night. We need to teach them how an entrepreneur and enterprise runs. It begins with awareness and then stepwise teaching them how to, launch an enterprise, how to run an enterprise, what are the problems they might be facing while running an enterprise. So all these needs to be taught. In our office, we have, people coming into with us, young people who wants to start their own enterprises coming to us and talking about, different challenges they're facing, not only in their businesses, but also in their home front. One engineer who wants to be an entrepreneur, after doing his graduation. Now he wants to be an entrepreneur. He comes to us and he says that, you know, I am not being supported by my family. Do we actually look into these aspects? Actually, as value chain operators of this particular, not only in value chain, I would speak about the entire entrepreneurial ecosystem. I would say that these things, which are, you know, maybe considered as soft interventions, including, I mean, not considering the hard ones, the technical ones, these are also very essential for any enterprise to flourish, to sustain. So I would just take, you know, a few examples, very not say that. Since I'm talking about micro enterprises, you know, that those, Madam has prior stated that these cannot come to that level, you know, that level where, you know, they are involved in import and export. So what can we do? What should be our role? You know, clusterizing this particular micro enterprises and inventorization of their, you know, products, the raw materials which are required, the forward linkages which we need to do, the marketing channels, the branding, the, you know, packaging, all this I feel should come in a package. It should be in a cluster approach so that, you know, this particular sector can go ahead. EDII has been working in Tripura with the Ministry of MSME, with SIDBI. We are working in clusters wherein we are giving inputs in marketing. We're giving inputs as, you know, BDS, that is, you know, business development services. Wherein we are talking about all this packaging, marketing, we're talking about how to develop an enterprise, how to sustain it. All these services are very essential for, you know, sustaining this. And I think it is not only bamboo. You know, in every sector, this is very important. Because in India, especially in the northeastern region, if you see, our economy is majorly governed by these micro enterprises. And we should, you know, take a pledge here that, you know, we will actually look into, you know, we're not comparing ourselves to Western countries, to other countries who are in a level which we cannot compare, ourselves with. Let us work in a way which will benefit our own region, our own entrepreneurs, our own enterprises which are willing to flourish in this area. So not, you know, not wanting to, like, you know, carry it much forward, because all has been said and done. So I would just like to finish this, you know, my small lecture which I have given here with a Chinese proverb. Give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Teach a man to fish and you feed him for a lifetime. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you for all the presentations. After a very long time, we have, you know, such a wonderful experts we are hearing on bamboo. Madam suggested that we can do it in a summarize all the experts, whatever they have said, and, you know, enlighten us. But I think as she is not here, so maybe I can, you know, give a general, just whatever she said. We have already covered from raw material to, you know, the complete supply chain and to the marketing and all. Karpeji has already, he's instrumental in, you know, structural and any utility products. And as usual, he has already shown beautiful products, activities, and structures and all. So, Muthu Kumarji, I just wanted to share one information that we are only supporting their products and all. We have discussed, our DG has a discussion with him, and in fact, we requested him for 2-3 products we are supporting to him. I understand that a lot of R&Ds are going on, but broadly as NMBA, we don't have that mandate. But as Nectar, though we don't support R&Ds, but for prototyping and all, we can support. So that way we can put you in that category. Inbar, I see a lot of potential. In fact, we have not explored. As NMBA, we have done a lot of work, but as NMBA and Nectar, we can see a lot of opportunities with you. So definitely we can join hands with you in future. Kamesh ji, as usual, he has shown enough the complete supply chain. Yes, these are the problems we already have, but as we rely on government policies only, I mean, we see government as, you know, they do everything and something like that. I think we need to create some kind of network where this can be sorted out, maybe in joint hand with, of course, government, but it should be in sync with that. I mean, we should not rely everything on government. So yes, definitely NBM has schemes, everything, mandate, but still they have their limitations also. So as Nectar, we are ready to do that. But of course, in...
I think so, comments, if you want to change mapping.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Without mapping, you can't do any industries.
Correct, correct. But normally we see that as, like earlier we were NMBA and now the NBM, they should do that. But I think let's see something, you know, beyond that also. So that's my submission to this. Dr. Bhuiya has already touched the raw material part. Definitely this is the backbone of any industry, especially in Northeast. Because though water everywhere, but no water to things like that. I mean, bamboo is everywhere, but the relevant species are not there. Means maybe they are there, but they're in very small quantities. So how to collect them? And again, the supply chain is a big issue, of course. We can see how we can, but we are again, I mean, as Nectar, we are open to that also. We don't have any restricted mandate, so we can work it on that part also. Sukanta ji, AB Composite is in this sector since beginning, and they are one of the best in their products, and especially in the construction sector. I think they have done more than a lakh square feet of construction pan India. That too, all kind of composites, jute composite, you know, and bamboo as a general also, hybrid type of, and all that. So again, we are open. Of course, for some time, I agree that there was some gap was there, but we are open again. We can definitely go ahead with that. Ashish ji has already touched upon the gaps which were just mentioned by Kamesh ji also and many other speakers. So definitely we need to have you, that's why I think you are here. We requested you to be here, that how these gaps can be filled on. Of course, government is already there, but how Nectar can, we try to see that how Nectar can be part of all this. The issues basically, of course, whatever everybody, I mean, experts or industries, they are doing their own, but how Nectar can be part of it. So that's why we requested you to be here. And regarding EDI, madam, we have already signed MOU with you, and that again, how, of course, not only bamboo but other sector also, how the entrepreneurship can be, you know, put in for the potential entrepreneurs and all that. So that trainings and all, we are open to all kind of entrepreneurs or potential entrepreneurs. We are ready to support that kind of training, and through, of course, you. And apart from EDI, BCDI is again, we have taken administrative control of BCDI, Agartala. So we have all complete set of training facility. Abhinav is there, he is already handling that. And we already have sanctioned schemes for pan-Northeast, because our domain is Northeast. So any potential entrepreneurs can be part of it. We are ready to, especially for clusters, maybe with no cost or very limited cost. That is again subject to the policy. Abhinav can tell better. We can give all kind of trainings. In fact, our testing facility for bamboo, which is not available in Northeast, is already created in BCDI. So that facility is also there, so that can be availed. So our point is that how we can help the sector, especially in the Northeast. Apart from that, I wanted to mention that we have a scheme called BANS, Bamboo Application Applied Scheme. Let's say we have N number of innovators also, and they have done something and they want to do the prototyping and beyond that also. So we have this scheme and we are ready to fund you, but the condition is that that needs to be done in Northeast only. So that is a techno-financial scheme with us. The details are already available on our website. So you can see that. So with this, may I request, actually, we were looking for co-chair also. He is also not here. So we want to felicitate all our entrepreneurs. Abhinav, can we request any senior person or official for felicitating our exploits? Ji? Abhinav, yes. So you can call. May I request Sanjeev Karpeji to kindly come here and. Now it becomes our session, so all our experts are part of our.
Just give me.
The local hand woven only. But normally you cannot distinguish between hand woven and the machine made. Yes. Kamesh Salam. With this, I'd like to close the session. In fact, we are quite late. We are supposed to close it by 4:30, and this is, I don't know what is the time, 5:30 or something. The other session is still pending. So let's see how we are, properly they are doing it. And may I request a group photo here with all the experts and later on with everybody. And, with this, we are closing the session. Thank you all the experts and participants to be here and part of this. We have other sessions also. We definitely would like to be there. In fact, I request you to part of our cultural session as well as the gala dinner also. So can you be here? Thank you. Good job.